In this video, I'll talk a bit about missing data, so if you have NAs in your data set, and how we can handle them in structural query modeling. Okay, so missing data analysis is actually a very complicated topic. It's a very a big topic as well. There are conferences about this, there are lots of papers about this. People do their entire PhD on missing data analysis. So I'm going to summarize it in a few slides, but it doesn't really do justice to the topic. The topic is much bigger than that. So I just want to teach you some of the very basics in missing data analysis, also that you can understand the literature on this a bit better, which are actually these, the most important things are actually these terms here, like MCAR and MAR and MNAR. But there's a lot more about this. So the main thing to worry about when you have missing data, so you have NAs in your data set, in R, right? The main thing to worry about is, why are there data missing? So why do we have this NA here? And that's a big and important question. And there can be roughly three reasons why your data is missing. So the first one is that, and we're going to talk about a general X predicts Y case. Now, X might be, in this case, like external variables, like grouping variables or gender, things like that. Y are the indicators we're interested in, okay? So in the first case, in missing completely at random, we're going to assume that the missingness of Y is independent of Y or X. So that actually means that it's actually missing fully at random, right? So there was no mechanism whatsoever. It's just that the person at random missed that response, for example. That can happen. But there is no structure whatsoever in it. Can happen. Of course, it's not very likely. So there's likely some reason why it's happening, why something is random. But this can happen. Then the other missing at random type that we have, which is also a good thing still, is missing at random. It's a bit weird, a bit confusing names here, but this is actually a different thing. So in missing at random, the missingness is independent of Y, but not of X. So what does that mean? That means that there are reasons why people are not giving an answer. But it has nothing to do with the answer they would have given otherwise. So for example, maybe men are less willing to respond to certain questions than women, or maybe you had a planned missingness design, so then the missingness is a function of the design and not the question you would have given. And you can think of other reasons like that. So if you have missing at random, things are still good, because your missingness does not depend on the answer you would have given. Right? So it doesn't mean, it means that you see a question and not like, I don't want to answer that. It's more like, okay, I don't want to answer it in general, but not really because I am afraid what people do if they see my response to that. In missing not at random, your missingness depends on Y itself. Okay, and what this means is that you see a question, you think, okay, I need to say yes to that, or I need to score high on that, but I don't want that. I don't want to give that response. For example, it might be a very sensitive issue, and people have no problem saying no to it, but they might have problems saying yes to it, like very severe mental health questions or things like that. Now, in these cases here, the missing at random and the missing completely at random, then this is fine. We can handle this. This is good. We're happy. But here, this is bad. We're unhappy, very unhappy. We're even crying, because this is then really bad. Because then, I'll show it in the next slides why it's bad. Unfortunately, there's no real way to know how the data is missing, because it's missing. So we don't see the data, and we can't ask the data why it's missing. We just have that NA in there. So there's no real reason to know how it's why it's missing. So then the typical solution is simply to assume, okay, let's just assume it's missing at random or missing completely at random. So we're in business and we can do things. That's of course one way to handle it, and it's what you will see often. But you could do a bit more. For example, you can go back to the people that gave missing response and try to get them anyway, and then test if the responses they gave are on average higher than people that did not give a response or did give a response there in their first test, things like that. Missing at random, you can test for a bit as well, because you can look at different populations, for example, men and women actually like give similar amounts of missing data or things like that. So there are some things you can do, and you can also reason for it. So maybe see one item and you really see like a very sensitive topic, and like your score pattern looks like zero has like a lot, and one is like few, and two is like nothing. But if you then look at the NA pattern, we see that nobody responds on the two, for example. Then we might reason that it might be Menarm, but we never know for sure. Oh, actually, we don't know this two, right? So we just have like a big missingness. Sorry. Okay, so let's give an example. So here we have two variables, a simple regression problem, because the missing data tactics, they all work for regression as well. And understanding it from a regression point of view makes it easier to understand it in every case, I think. So we have X, some predictor here, let's say age or something. And we have Y, and it's some output variable here. Okay, so now we have, I simulated 50% of the data and I just made them at random missing. So I just made some of these points missing at random. And then I made a similar plot here where you can see what that would look like. So now these blue dots are observed data, and these black dots are missing data, basically. And this black line here is the line corresponding to what you would get from the full data set. And this blue line is for the line which you get from the observed data. And this is mostly the same. You just get like a random part of this cloud you get as observed data. So this is mostly the same result that you would get before. Now I'm simulating MAR. So what you see here is that everything above this part is missing, which is a function of X, but not of Y, right? So then Y is fine. So here see another example here. For example, the higher you get on X, the more you have missingness. Yeah. So now what we see is that we would still get the same kind of regression slope, which is very similar still. We just cut off here, but the cloud doesn't really differ on the left side of this. So the regression slope is very similar still, which is a good thing. But now if we go to the Menarm problem, where now I make the data missing that has would have otherwise had a high value, like sensitive item, and then we can see it, we're actually going to cut off like a big part on the vertical area, right? So we're going to cut off this whole area here. What we then see is that we're sort of flattening our cloud. So now the estimated effect is much weaker than it would have been if you had all data. So we get a completely different result. And that would be a problem. Right? That can be a very big problem. All right. So how do we deal with missing data if you just assume it's Menarm or Makar? If you assume it's MAR or Makar, so we can do something with it. Well, there's some older methods, very old actually, because the newer methods already like decades old as well. But there are some older methods, and one would be that, okay, well, we have this S matrix, this covariance structure, right? And we put it as input in our FML function that we have. So we just need an estimate for this. So one thing we can do is we can just do list-wise deletion, right? So we have our data set. Let's say, okay, I have two variables here. That's not really that false wrong. Oh. Okay, let's have our data set here. And then let's suppose I have a missing data point here and here. Well, I could just cut out these rows, use these three to get an S matrix. And I can always do that, and then I'm in business, right? So I have three N is three observations. I can put it in the SEM software, and we're good. Another option is to compute as pairwise. It's similar, but what I'm then going to do is, let's say I add one more row here. And let's say here everything is observed. Then I can see that here actually I would have two observations here that have, let's say A, B, C. Here there's a case that doesn't have C, but for the correlation between A and B, their data is fine. So I could estimate the covariance between A and B, or the correlation between A and B, using this case as well. So what I do is, for every pair, I compute the correlation or the covariance. Right? So I just construct S, which is a 3x3 matrix. And I can just compute every element separately. So let's say I'm computing this element, the covariance between A and B. Then I can use this one, this one, this one, and this one. So I have n=4 for that case. And that's the idea behind pairwise estimation. Now, listwise estimation works really well. The only problem is that we're not using data that we have, right? So we'd also delete data, that's perfectly fine. Pairwise estimation also works well, but the problem is that this is much less clear what your sample size is, because the sample size is different per cell. And another problem is that S might not be a valid variance covariance matrix, because it has to be positive definite or positive semi-definite, which is basically the same as saying that a variance should be above zero. For a variance covariance matrix, it should be positive definite. It's a thing. And that might no longer be the case. So your software might complain a lot when you do this. In network estimation, actually, to get like a little detour, people are doing this. There is no missing data handling yet, except for in the psychometrics package with FIML, which I'll talk about now. So people usually do listwise deletion or pairwise deletion. It's quite common still. All right, the last method that you see quite often is to impute data. And that works quite well. What you do then is you impute data by regressing, say, one variable and all other variables, and then imputing predicted values from the observed or the present data. There's some really nice packages for this, and they work quite well. And you can also do multiple imputations where you like, compute the data 5 times, and you look at 5 different results, see if they're the same. This works quite well, but it can be pretty complicated. And if your data is missing and not at random, you can also increase the bias by this. So that might not be what you want as well. So I always find it tricky. I rather never do it imputation, because you're just adding data. Like these cases here, we're not adding anything. We're just like, you know, working around NAs. But here we're actually just putting data in our data. So I'm not that much of a fan of it, but you'll see this used a lot as well. Now, the best way to handle missing data in structural equation modeling, I think, is to use full information maximum likelihood estimation. And what we then do is we simply do maximum likelihood estimation, like we've been doing in the course all the time. But instead of using the FML that I showed earlier and had a video on, where I use the covariance matrix as input, I compute the likelihood per observation. And this makes use of a very nice property of the Gaussian distribution. And that is that the covariance structure of, let's say, the first two variables, the marginal covariance structure, is simply the covariance structure of the first three variables with the third row and the third column cut out. So that's a very nice property. And this is actually quite easy to compute. Okay, if I have, let's say I have a model for three variables, A, B, and C, but I only have A and B, what would then be the marginal distribution? So the distribution, given that we don't know C, you can very easily compute that. So you can very easily put it in your estimator as well. This assumes MAR as well. A downside is that you need full data. And that's a bit of a shame, because it's nice that we can like put this covariance matrix in our appendix and then have people be able to reproduce our analysis perfectly. So that's a bit of a shame. But other than that, it can also be slower, but actually most software now is quite fast handling this. So other than that, it works very well. okay, to give some very technical detail behind this, this is what the fit function looks like in for FIML. This is one way, this is the way I do the psychometrics. And what I actually do, this is actually the same as I said before, the FML function. But what I do is I compute this per group of data that has the same missingness pattern. So let's say I have a data set, and A, let's say like this. Then I can see that these two have the same pattern and these two have the same pattern. So I just simply compute this function once for this group with only these observations and once for this group with all observations. Then you add the result and then you get your fit function. Another way to do it would be to really go over every possible case or do this per case.